Hi, everybody. I'm Mike.
I'm Matt.
We are Armchair Directors.
You want a juice box and some cheese strings?
Yeah, we're here to talk about Ant-Man and the Wasp. But before we get to that, just another quick reminder. December 1st, the Armchair Directors Patreon is launching. So if you want to support the channel, we're going to be starting a Patreon. There will be different levels to support. And there will also be different rewards. Things like you can join us on roundtables to discuss movies. Join us for our commentary group chats. Those are always a blast. So that'll be coming December 1st. More info as the weeks go by. Ant-Man and the Wasp, fantastic sequel to the original Ant-Man. Absolutely loved it. Super fun and very refreshing after the giant, colossal, epic movie where nothing mattered, in my opinion. Yeah. Avengers Infinity War.
It was totally a refreshing change of pace after Infinity War, where it's the fate of the galaxy at stake and all this stuff. And this is much smaller stakes, but it's so fun. And they just ride the charisma of Paul Rudd and Evangeline Lilly. It carries the day. And it still has those fun, pure action scenes where we're dealing with the big and the small and shrinking. And it's just creative, and it feels like, you know, a lot of childhood fantasies are coming to life with this Ant-Man who can shrink and be small. And I love seeing, like, Luis gets small and just his reaction, because Michael Pena, still one of the best. Every time he's on the screen, I'm just laughing. Luis is hilarious.
Luis on truth, like, Luis on his own is awesome. Luis on truth serum, yeah, is just a little better.
And that was a great running gag about the truth serum, which was so good. And I just thought that this movie takes everything you liked about the first Ant-Man. They add a little bit more scale to it, but it's still just, if you like that one, guess what? This is more of the same, but in a good way.
Yeah, it was more of the same, but it wasn't too much more of the same.
It wasn't the same movie. It was, they used it in a good way to naturally build like a sequel should.
It was very similar in tone and pacing and jokes and feel. So if you love the first one like I did, you probably love the second one. But they didn't just keep bringing back the old stuff that worked so well. The thing in particular is the shrink foo. That's what I call the shrinking fighting style, where he would shrink and then grow and all that stuff. Called it shrink foo in the first movie, and I loved it. It was amazing. And I noticed in this movie, very enjoyable, very fun time. But by the end of it, like, there wasn't much shrink foo in this movie.
Right.
There was enough to make me satisfied that I saw some shrink foo, but I'm glad they didn't have, you know, an hour and a half of shrink foo. I'm right. Like, okay, all right, we've seen, they know you've seen it, and they don't overdo what you liked about the first one. They bring a little bit of it back, but they don't overdo it, which I appreciated. Mm-hmm. And then in the first, the Ant-Man review, one of the things I said was, why Rudd, right? He was fine. He was good. He was enjoyable, but why Rudd? Like, when you're casting a decades old character who goes, we got to get Paul Rudd for this. I get it in this movie. Why Rudd? Because of the dynamic between his character and the daughter.
Yeah.
So that wouldn't have worked if you got another guy who would have made a great Ant-Man superhero. They needed someone more who would be a loving father. Mm-hmm. They needed a good father more than they needed a good superhero. So that's why Rudd, because Paul Rudd is pure heart when he's with that little girl.
Yeah.
It is so touching. It is such beautiful scenes between the two. And I get why Rudd now. It was nothing to do with the suit.
Right.
It was all about the caring for the daughter.
Yeah, and that relationship between Scott and Cassie is one of the strongest things in these movies. You know, everything he's doing is to make sure his daughter has, like, a better life. And he tries to stay on the straight and narrow for her. And I just love the interplay of Paul Rudd and just about anybody. You know, yes. Randall Park as the agent who's making sure that he's staying home and he's following. They have some really funny lines, especially near hilarious. The end where, you know, he asks if he wants to go to lunch. And he's like, what? Just ridiculous stuff. And I love seeing, they brought in, you know, first movie had Michael Douglas. We got like a classic actor playing Hank Pym, this heavy role. And when we needed Hank Pym's estranged partner, they bring in Lawrence Fishburne. And I'm like, hell yeah, this is the guy. And then when they needed to get Janet, we get Michelle Pfeiffer. And it's just like, these are actors that are so good, and having them all together on the screen just feels, you know, you get the nostalgia feels for their old roles, but also they work, and it's just nice seeing them on the screen. Even when they do the de-aging, man, that scene with Pfeiffer and Douglas in the beginning, you're like, oh my god, this technique is really come a long way from the X-Men Last Stand days, and it's cool to see our old favorite actors so young and so old all in the same movie.
Yeah, Tron Legacy jumped to mind when I saw Hank Pym DH in this movie, and I went, oh, so that's how you do it. even though it's called Ant-Man and the Wasp, it's an ensemble cast.
Oh, yeah.
And there's not that many movies where so many of the ensemble cast are awesome.
Yeah.
So Scott is awesome. Hank Pym, just as an aside, I love that we were introduced to Ant-Man in a movie and Hank Pym's already an old guy. And he's already passing the baton down to the new Ant-Man.
Yeah.
It's kind of like if instead of rebooting Spider-Man again, if they instead had decided to use an old Peter Parker, handing it down to Miles Morales or something like that, the new character. And I would like to see that done more often, you know, where they there aren't that many superheroes left, but how about having an old Bruce Wayne hand it down in like a Batman Beyond live action movie? You know, I just love the idea of Hank Pym has had his day. He's had his adventures. We get to have a glimpse of one of those adventures, but it's in the past, you know, so that I just like how that plays out. And the FBI agent was hilarious too. You know, the interplay with him, and then Walton Goggins,
right?
He's awesome too, right?
Yeah.
And he should just be the typical money-hungry, pain-in-the-butt villain, but I really enjoyed him in this movie.
Yeah.
You know, like he was a great example of doing so much more than he should have been able to with what little he was given.
Yeah, well, I totally agree. Everybody who just shows up, even if it's only for a little bit, they nailed the casting. Goggins is good, and I liked Ghost. I thought Ghost had an interesting story.
Yeah,
she's pretty dynamic.
I like that the villains weren't evil.
Right.
There's no real evil. There's a greedy guy in this movie, and there's some angry people who are in pain, like an angry person who's in pain. But there's no one who's really evil. So I enjoyed that too.
And giving Ghost that thing where basically her whole motivation is that she's in pain and just wants it to stop is something that's relatable to a lot of people. And I love that they have that moment. We're going to obviously get into some minor spoilers here, I think, where she is willing to go so far as to kidnap the daughter. And Lawrence Fishburne is like, hold up. I understand you're in pain. I understand this, but we don't cross that line. You know, there's everything else I'm cool with, but like, we don't go after that. And having him be a moral center at that moment really worked. And it made me identify with Ghost more that she said, okay, like I will adhere to that. And, you know, Fishburne, even though him and Michael Douglas, Hank Pym, are estranged or whatever, he wasn't just a pure evil guy. He was just trying to actually help somebody because they were in pain. And I thought that was really interesting. And having the female villain worked well, especially when we've got such a great female hero in the Wasp. The dynamic between Ant-Man and Wasp when they have to team up, and the fact that they're so much stronger when they work together than when they're apart, I thought was a nice touch.
Yeah, with Fishburne, I'm glad he wasn't a piece of garbage. I can't speak for others, but I really enjoy him, his work, because of his work as Morpheus. He'll always be Morpheus to me. That guiding light, that moral compass. And don't make him a piece of crap, you know? Like, that's not what he's good at. And I just like that he played a character who was similar to Morpheus in this movie, so I enjoyed that. And I did like the dynamic between Wasp and Ant-Man, a little bit of banter. Thank God she grew those bangs out.
Yeah, definitely a better look in this one.
All the action was great too, like we've mentioned before. Let's do best part.
Worst part.
Best part for me, there's so many great parts of this. Not to say it was miles ahead of everything else, but that FBI agent. I just love that in a Marvel movie with all this incredible futuristic, amazing technology and very, very high stakes and all that stuff, that you can have these quirky little fun scenes like the FBI agent, you know, his banter with Scott Lang. And it's just a chuckle when you need it every right. couple minutes to keep it lighthearted. Oh, but also, I guess this is tied for best part. I like that the point of the movie was saving a wife and a mother from this weird neither realm that she was trapped in for decades. Mm-hmm. Again, a refreshing change from saving the world. So many comic book movies are about saving the world, and I get desensitized. I get burned out on saving the world. I'm like, man, the world needs saving so much. I'm just tired of this world needing to be saved.
Yeah.
And I really liked it. It brought so much heart and soul. There's no heart and soul in saving the world, right? They don't show us all of the little tender moments of the goodness that happens when you save the world.
Right.
It's just, there's the world safe. But we got to see some amazing scenes between Janet being reunited. Oh my God, that scene with her and Hank.
Yeah.
Amazing. And then with the daughter too, just awesome. Awesome. Get chills thinking about it right now. Mm-hmm. That's heart and soul. And, that's why I love so many Marvel movies, because they really know how to bring that, that personal touch to the movie. Worst part for me, it was just a minor annoyance. The glitchy suit. Like, God, come on. Like, these things do such amazing things, right? Like, it's impossible, fantastical, shrink down and grow. And you're going to tell me the button is malfunctioning or, like, a coupler has come loose? Come on. It's annoying.
Yeah.
It's annoying that that's, like, what they use to create a sense of suspense and danger. It's like, how much trouble would this guy be in if a coupler came loose?
Right.
He'd be... That's it. He's done. Just because, like, soldering came loose or some silly thing, a fuse blew. That's just a minor annoyance of mine, though.
I also was kind of annoyed by that, but I loved the sequence where Paul Rudd is, like, half size just because the suit's not working right. Seeing him as, like, a toddler size walking around and then getting into the van, just really funny. So it served the comedy if it didn't quite serve the story as well.
It reminded me of Deadpool when he was with the shirt.
Yeah. Worst part is not even actually a fault of this movie. It's that you're having such a good time and you're ready to shut it off with a big smile on your face. And then we get the tie-in to Infinity War where all of a sudden everybody except Ant-Man turns to ash. And it's such a jarring tonal shift that obviously everybody after Infinity War wanted to know where was Ant-Man and what happened. But it's so such a dark note to end on for a movie that is just a good feel-good family flick that, yeah, we sort of needed that, but it also was so jarring tonally that I was just like, okay. And I was also disappointed that, like, literally everybody disappeared except for Ant-Man in the Quantum Realm. So it's like, all right, what's going to happen next? We'll figure that out, I guess, in months.
Yeah, it's supposed to be half.
Yeah.
And instead, in order to make it seem like a dangerous situation for Ant-Man, it was all of them.
It happened to be all of them.
Yeah. It's not consistent with what they established. And that's, you can't do that, right? You can't set a rule in stone and keep beating that drum and saying, this is the rule, this is the rule. And then, actually, it would serve us better if we broke this rule.
So I guess the FBI agent didn't dust away. He's probably fine.
Yeah,
so.
But they didn't show it on screen, though. Yeah. Although, that thing worked for me. It was jarring. It didn't go with the rest of the movie. But I liked it, actually. I like that post-credit scene, and here's why. This movie came out after Avengers Infinity War, and I went, what? Chronologically it takes place before but they released it after, and I went, come on, like, just release it before. Like, they have this stuff planned out. If they knew it was coming, if it was happening before Infinity War, release it before Infinity War instead of having a prequel a couple months later.
Right.
This is literally a few months after a movie, and it's a prequel to that movie, or it takes place before chronologically. So that's the one thing I thought, that's business getting involved here. We got to release this smaller movie in August, and we got to release the big movie, you know, at the beginning of the summer. I'm like, don't, you know, I understand the business side of it, but I don't like it when the flow of the story is impacted by business projections.
Right.
So with that on my mind, when that thing happened, I went, okay, we're good now. Because the end of Ant-Man. Yeah, the end of Ant-Man, you could say Ant-Man didn't take place before Infinity War. It took place during Infinity War. And then the end of Ant-Man is actually at the end of Infinity War.
Yeah.
So it's sort of
they balance the timeline by the end of it.
Yeah, everything is, now you're ready for the next, whatever it is, Captain Marvel or Infinity War 2, Electric Boogaloo. So yeah, that's, it was the best they could do with the situation that they created for themselves.
And then best part is just still the charisma of everybody involved and the funny dialogue. You know, Paul Rudd is just likable throughout. And like I said, anytime Louise is on screen, it's just a good time. That's a character that they use just enough to have me wanting more. But it's like a Lando where you don't give me too much so I don't get sick of him. You give me just enough so that I still love that guy. And
his underlings at the office are really funny too.
Yeah, that whole crew is great. And giving them a little bit more to do in like the final act, I thought was really good because they sort of integrated into the story more when they get tied up with Goggins and all that stuff. So I like that the whole team and ensemble dynamic is utilized really well throughout. And it is just fun to see Evangeline Lilly and Paul Rudd teaming up and kicking butt. So if you liked the first Ant-Man, you're going to like the second one because it's more of the same, but in the way that a great sequel should be, the feeling of the first, but expanding it a bit.
Yeah, maybe one way to put it is if you like a first movie and you don't like the second movie, and it, that seems strange because it's more of the same. How come I'm not enjoying the second one? It's just like the first one. And the reason is because there wasn't enough of an idea to fuel two or three movies.
Yeah,
it's
it
a one
just be
movie
a greatest hits. Yeah.
Yeah, so there's a lot of series that was a one movie idea and they try to stretch it out. Highlander and you know, let us know in the comments other movies that were one movie ideas. And they stretched them for too many movies. This wasn't a one movie idea. They planted the seed for that whole thing. That was, you know, that was something I wanted to see resolved. Can they find Janet? Can they find the wife? Mm-hmm. The mother? They set that up from the first movie. It's kind of like with Guardians of the Galaxy. They set up the second movie, right? They left that loose end. Watching this second movie, it's definitely a two movie idea. We'll see if it's a three movie idea too.
Yeah, and it'll be interesting to see how all of these characters tie in to Infinity War 2, Electric Boogaloo. And I'm hoping that, you know, Ant-Man and some of them will have a bigger role because I love seeing him in Civil War and his dynamic with the Avengers, and I want to see more of that. So looking forward to it.
And I'm just sad that we never got to see that scene of Ant-Man shrinking down and trying to pull a gem out of the Infinity Gauntlet.
We still might.
You know, trying to pry it out. But yeah, definitely a fun time, as with most Marvel movies. Let us know what you thought of Ant-Man and the Wasp in the comments below. Thanks so much for watching, and until next time.
Enjoy the show.